Can you talk to us a bit about the casting call and the process that you went through to find the fabled Alex Rider?
Yes, I think it started with a casting call nationwide, and I think we saw about more than 1,000 guys for this part, and I met a lot of people, and we had one day where, you know, it came down to, I think, 6 or 8, and this poor guy had to, you know, play the scenes over and over and over again, not just in front of me, in front of this gentleman here, in front of, I don't know, 5 executive producers.
There was a lot of people in the room.
Yes, and in the end, there could only be one guy playing Alex Rider, and this is this gentleman here.
And what was it about Otto then that caught your eye and that made that decision for you?
I mean, you've seen him on the screen, and it's kind of awkward to talk about him when he's sitting right next to me. But he had, I mean, first of all, you needed somebody who's looking like he's 16 or something, and who is not 16, because otherwise you get in trouble, you know, with the working hours and all this kind of thing.
Yeah. Who has slave labor, yeah.
Yes, and who has the ability to, you know, be a real person and not just an actor, who is able to transform his personality to the screen, and who has also the stamina to, you know, work for what 100 and whatever shooting days we had. And I think he has the potential to be a big star. I mean, first of all, we needed to, you know, find the right actress for Jack, who is sitting right next to me, because this kind of family is strange, because there's this uncle and then there's Jack, and so she's kind of the heart of the whole story. We had to find the best friend, Tom, and I don't want to talk about Vicky when she's sitting right next to me.
How is it seeing them transformed onto the screen then?
It's sort of extraordinary. I still can't quite get over the fact that I am now sitting next to Alex Rider, a character I've lived with for 20 years, and now suddenly here he is, played by Otto, and played to perfection. I could not be happier. As to Brennock, who you saw briefly on the video, in the books, as anybody who's read them knows, Tom is a tiny character, but Brennock is so spectacularly good in the part that the character is almost equal to Alex. I mean, the scenes when the two of them are together are such fun, there's so much energy, that now when I'm writing the books, actually Tom is almost as big a character as Alex.
Did it feel like you, when you first saw Otto, was there a bit of a moment where you're just like, that's the guy?
Well, I'll tell you something. In that, you know, you talked about the casting process, and I remember that all these actors were finally down to about 18 or 20 people who were doing Jack and Tom and Alex and different versions of them. And the moment that Ronke and Brennock and Alex came together, every single person in the room, every suit, every person there involved knew we had our cast. It was something magic happened, and you'll see it on the screen.
How does it feel to finally be unveiled as such an iconic character?
It feels great. It's kind of strange. I've never been in a room with this many people before.
What were those final auditions like? Did you know that you got the gig, or was it? Did they keep you guessing?
No, I had no idea. I knew that when I was in the room with Ronke and Brennock, that I was really having fun with them, and I knew that. I even said to Brennock, if we both did this, it would be a real laugh. And I know we would have 6 months of just enjoying ourselves. And that's what we did. So when I got the job, I was like, over the moon.
I mean, presumably you grew up reading the books as well. So you'd, in your head, you'd already played Alex Rider many times.
Yeah, it's weird, actually. I wasn't a big reader when I was a kid. I was kind of more into like maths and stuff. But then the only books that I was really into, because my sibling read them, was Alex Rider. And funnily enough, Point Blank was my favorite of the Alex Rider books.
Amazing.
And here we are putting Point Blank on screen, which is cool.
Jack represents, I guess, the stability. You know, he's got two sides to his story here. And you're the grounding influence on him, aren't you? What was your experience working kind of with Alex, with Otto, with Brennock and all those kind of guys? How was it for you?
It was such a pleasure. We had such a good time, and it was so easy to kind of enter into that space of best friends, big sister, kind of home body. So I had an amazing time. It was wonderful.
Did you click straight away? Did it take a while?
I think so. No. I don't think it took a while at all. I think we clicked.
In the audition?
At the auditions.
Yeah.
I guess that's why you got the gig. Jack's kind of a stabilizing force throughout all of the episodes then. Is she going to get swept up into a hellhole of espionage?
Oh no, those are secrets. I can't tell you any of that. But she loves Alex and will do anything for him.
She doesn't stay at home for the whole series, though. We can say that, right? There are Mrs. Jones and Jack moments later on, so...
I didn't write the screenplay to this series. I was busy working on the next Alex Rider novel, Nightshade, out next year, just thought I'd mention it. So I passed writing duties over to Guy, and he took over, and I can't tell you how excited I am by the fact that he's been so true to the spirit of Point Blank and of the characters and the plot and everything, but has really made it his own and expanded the world and made it more adult and darker, and in some ways even, I think, more intense than the book. He just did a great job, but I didn't. It's not...
thank you.
Well, I would say that, wouldn't I? In fact, all these people. Talk to you later.
Do you find it easy to hand over your characters for someone else to kind of run away with a little
bit? Yeah, television is about collaboration. If you don't trust the team, and I was lucky because the 11th Hour Films gave me the dream team. If you don't trust the team, you're just going to, you know, you're going to do yourself no good. So I was happy to take a back seat. I kept watch on everything, but I didn't really get involved. I didn't need to.
So from my point of view, it's really lovely to be able to take something that's already a cracking story and a very thrilling story, and look at how we can expand it, what other characters we can bring in, how we can dig into the sort of emotional side of it a little more, because I think that that's worth doing. Especially when you're seeking to reach an older audience, it's worth looking at how these characters might feel about what's happening to them. And we spend a lot of time thinking about Alex and the impact on him that would come from really being thrown into the deep end of a world that he never even dreamed existed. He had no idea his uncle was a spy. He had no idea that his uncle was killed in the line of duty until it all comes crashing down on him.
Yeah.
It's a really tricky one to navigate. This is the thing that scares me most, because there are so many millions of fans of the books out there. And when you read the book, you get a very clear picture of a 14-year-old Alex, and you get a very clear picture of his world. And we have pulled that a little. We've pulled him a little older, we've pulled the tone a little grittier, tried to make things a bit more grounded. But we have absolutely, I promise you, tried to stay true to the spirit of Anthony's novels. So it's the same Alex. It's just that we're trying to make it a little bit more grounded in the real world.
Yeah. I guess the department is the darker side of the books.
They are.
Anyway, so...
And they're kind of a scary force, because on the one hand, they're supposed to be the government, they're supposed to be protecting us, but on the other hand, they are coercing Alex into doing this job, and they are kind of responsible for his uncle's death as well.
The truth is that when I wrote the Alex Rider books, they were always said to be adult books for kids. They were never really meant to be sort of ordinary children's books. And it was very important for the TV show. We all agreed from the start that this was not going to be children's television. It was a difficult balancing act, because we had to appeal to a wide adult audience whilst at the same time not alienating younger viewers by being too violent, too adult, too serious, or whatever. I didn't particularly get involved. In fact, if I may say so, it's probably Andreas who should answer that question, because the moment Andreas came into the picture, he completely understood the tone, which was this not even family drama, but serious adult drama that would still appeal to kids.
Some good stunt skills. Rumor has it that you are pretty. You're the young Daniel Craig. You insist on doing your own. You are Tom Cruise without the broken foot.
I tried to do as much as they would let me. There's a. If you've read the books, you'll know that there's a big snowboarding sequence at the end of the book, which we actually shot before anything else. And I wasn't allowed to do that, because if I had broken my leg, I probably wouldn't have been Alex Rider. So I didn't get to do that, but mostly I tried to do as much as I was allowed to.
That's a dream come true, isn't it, to get to do all that kind of stuff?
Yeah, yeah. It's really cool to see it all come to life on screen as well, because it's very technical, you know. A stunt is quite a hard thing to achieve, and then you see it on screen, it looks so cool. Like, there's some great fights, and there's a great fight in episode 8 which I don't know if I'm allowed to talk about.
No spoilers. Spoilers. Vicky McClure, ladies and gentlemen, everybody. How are you doing?
Yeah, I'm good.
Now, what can you tell us about the mysterious Mrs. Jones?
Well, I don't want to spoil too much. I think that scene explains well what our department is. The great thing about the series is you're in lots of different locations at different times, and when you're in the department, you know, it's great for Alex and to sort of discover what his new role is.
Yeah.
But as Mrs. Jones, she has an energy with him, and then like a relationship with Blunt and a relationship with Crawley, and yet she's quite a parenting with Alex as well. So I got to play lots of different
feelings in it, which was
nice, rather than just being sort of a direct spy, so to speak.
Is it fair to say her moral compass is constantly wavering?
Yes, exactly. Yeah, I should have said that.
Pardon?
I should have said that.
No, your answer was longer, which makes it better. What appealed to you about Mrs. Jones and the show, you know, in terms of the tone and the style and stuff?
Well, I was honest from the start. I'd not heard or read the books because I'm a bit older than Otto.
You're not.
But I asked my nephew, who's 12 years old, and said, have you ever heard of a book called Alex Rider? And I got a response of, yeah, like I was stupid. So obviously I went and did my research, and it's great. It's an amazing job to be part of something that is pure adventure. You know, there's so much action in it. And, yeah, I didn't even really consider not doing it because it was a great part.
What have we got to look forward to? I guess, does Mrs. Jones go on a bit of a journey alongside Alex?
Yeah, I mean, we had loads of scenes together and we had a lot of fun. There's lots of stuff in the department as well, but I do have to wear a snowsuit at one point, which I really liked.
There aren't many people that I would kind of like, my legs would go to jelly stood in front of, but Stephen Delane is probably one of them. He terrifies me, just as a human
being. You and me both.
What's he like? What's he like to do stuff with?
I wish he was here.
Yeah.
He's got the driest sense of humour, hasn't he?
I didn't understand it at first. Yeah. I didn't get the sense of humour, but as we did shot more and more,
is he taking the mick out of me?
Yeah, yeah.
Not daft. It gets to the point where you all get, you know, it gets to about 4 o'clock, everyone's a bit tired, and then everyone gets like the silly hour, and he started to join in. So I saw a completely different side to him. He's great. I mean, he's fantastic in this, but he was really special to work with, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's just his voice, isn't it? As well?
He's great as well because he's constantly testing you in the scene, but also kind of as a person. He keeps you on your toes because obviously he requires the best quality of work, you know? So it's great. You feel like you have to rise to his level, which is really, really fantastic. And Vicky as well.
There were different approaches for this whole point blank thing in the scripts, but I think it was over Christmas when I was watching The Shining again, and I thought this might be, you know, an interesting lead for the Point Blank Academy, and then we tried to find something of like The Shining in the middle of London, and found a location which kind of delivered a lot of the atmosphere there. And then we had a lot of discussions, should they wear school uniforms and all these kind of things. And then we found this kind of uniforms, and we found great actors and actresses to play these other parts and to give the whole thing a kind of global feel, because Dr. Greif's plan is, you know, to take over the world. So he needed people from all over the planet. And I was very happy with the people that came together for this.
What made you want this project to be your first English-speaking production? What made you take the leap?
Yeah, I was wondering why they brought in a guy from Austria, but maybe because I did the submarine thing first, or two horror movies were...
Andreas, if you don't know, Andreas directed the incredible Das Boot series that was on earlier this year. Was it late last year?
It was this year.
Yeah, it was this year. Absolutely fantastic.
Thank you. No, but when... I had no idea who Alex Rider was until I got the script, and I thought this is a really cool thing, and I wanted to do something that appeals to myself and to my kids One of my sons is here in the audience. He's 16, and he really loved it.
It passed the sun test, did it?
Yes.
The most stringent.
Yes, tests. I mean, every time I finished an episode, I gathered my family in front of the computer and said, "Watch this. Do you like it?" And they loved it. So I was happy. And I thought this coming of age thing combined with the spy world is really unique. So yes, I read the script, and I was happy that they, you know, brought me in.
And just watching from the clips, I've been lucky enough to see the first episode, which is amazing, and just seeing the clips here, it's got a very cinematic feel. It doesn't feel like a TV show. How is that? What's the magic dust that you managed to sprinkle on it?
I mean, you start with images in your head, and you try to find, you know, the best people to support your vision, and I found them. You need a great production designer, you need a great DP, you need a great casting director who brings you together with all those people, and then hopefully, you know, your plans work out. And I mean, in the beginning, I know what I didn't want. And that was a kind of a good start.
Marley, who plays Kyra, is here there. Now, she's a new character, right?
She is a new character.
Tell us a little bit about Kyra, then.
It felt very important to me going into the series that we have a female character of Alex's age who balances him in some way. Because in the books, there are some girlfriends along the way, but nobody who is, if you like, a kind of match for him. And we see Kyra as a character who could return in further seasons. And she has her own skill set, which is a much geekier, more computer-driven skill set than Alex's is. I kind of had in my head a teenage version of Lisbeth Salander from The Girl with the Dragon Tattoo, if that makes sense.
Good reference, yeah.
Yeah, it's just someone who's on the cool end of geeky.
Without the stapling the feet into the floor.
I'm on the geeky spectrum, but I'm not enough on the cool end of it. So I like to write people who are both. In my head, season three is mapped out.
Season three?
Yeah, because I need to know that in order to think about season two. Because you need to know where you're finishing season two in order to kick that off. So I'm ridiculously ahead of the curve here, and you know, quite happy, enjoying it.
We were talking about, you know, what we're going to do with these characters, and having got so many fantastic actors, how we're going to give them interesting things to do in the next season and the one after. That's absolutely right. Two and three, which I think are going to be fairly closely tied together, are already underway in Guy's head, which is great.
The landscape technologically has changed quite substantially from 20 years ago, and with gadgetry being such an important part of being a super spy, how did you, Guy in particular, adapt that kind of gadgetry and technology to today's world?
There's always a moment in the book where Alex is handed a palette of gadgets that play a big role in the story. My feeling, and you can nail me to the wall on this if you have to, is that the best gadget that Alex has been given along the way comes from his uncle, and it's the skill set that's in his head, not whatever tools he's been given to carry in his pockets. And I was very keen that what we see him doing at the start of the show, which is breaking back into the school using a paperclip to get into a desk, that is all built in. So we see him later faced with much more scary situations where he uses those skills to get out. And there's less of a reliance on the technological gadgets. He does get given something. It doesn't work.
I've had a blast with so many different things. I've loved doing we talked about the stunts and stuff. I really enjoyed doing the stunts. I think what's been so fun is that every single episode in this series is so different, and we go to so many different locations, and it was great to inhabit those different worlds. And I think you're going to see a few different Alexes in those different worlds, which was just a joy to kind of find along the way. You know, it's an origin story, but really what you're watching is me as Otto finding the character each episode at a time. So that was, to be honest, just playing it and learning and finding it was the best.
With this trailer, Stormbreaker seems to have been cut completely. Is that coming back in a later season, or was the movie so bland that it traumatized that book forever?
Well...
Why don't you get... Don't sit on the fence, mate, whatever you do.
Look, The film was what the film was, but the fact is it was made and we moved on from it. So we start with Point Blank as being the first in this TV series. And we, you will see in the series that some elements, the origin elements of Ian Ryder's death and how Alex becomes a spy, have been built into this. But you know, that was then, that was a 9-year-old film, and it was made for a slightly different, probably a more American audience. I'm thrilled with what we've done this time round. This is a show, actually, that I wish the film had been.
I think it's safe to say it looks the opposite of bland. I think we can all agree on that. Thank you very much for your question, though. God bless you, son. Over to you.
We just took Ian's backstory and what happens to Ian. Ian is Alex's uncle, for those of you who don't know. And we moved that up into the beginning of this, so it becomes the first episode, really, is Alex suffering this loss and then realizing that the story he's been told about it is a lie. And the more he digs into that, and the more indignant he becomes about the fact that he's been told nonsense about his own uncle who he loves, the more he uncovers the world of the department and Alan Blunt and Mrs. Jones. So it's a really useful origin story and it's important to tell it. But as we were explaining to the chap over there, we wanted to start fresh with a different book, different place, and just take it from there. So it informs emotionally the whole series, actually.
To see the power of five on the screen, you know, I'm waiting any producers in the hall come and talk to me afterwards. I mean, yeah, I think that it's interesting that the show has, the books, I think, have got darker and darker as they've gone on. And what I like about the show is, although it is quite dark, it hasn't lost sight of the fact that it's still meant to be entertaining and has its cheerful moments. But in answer to your question, yeah, sure, I'd love to see the point of the power of five. And for that matter, some of my other books on the screen, I live in hope.
All of them, right, Anthony? Every single
well,
one?
Well, whatever, you know. Can I say how much more I liked your question than the first one? Thanks.
You're welcome. Cheers.
In terms of the future life of this series, of course, look, there are 14 Alex Ryder books. That could be 14 more years of Alex on TV. At the end of the day, that decision is really down to you, to the audience. If you like the show, if it does well, we'll be back. But it's encouraging that, you know, the people who've seen it so far have been really positive, and that Guy and I are already commissioned to be writing and working on the next season. So that's a good sign. Yasin's here somewhere. Isn't Yasin in the audience too? Do we have a crazy Russian assassin somewhere in the building?
Somewhere.
Maybe.
Stand
keeping,
up if
keeping
you're there.
They've gone after that other lad.
Keeping a low profile, as Yasin would. You'll see, Guy's worked it out really cleverly, that Yasin, although he originally appears in Stormbreaker, he comes now into Point Blank and repeats his role there, and is going to become, I think, a really interesting and dark and serious character in the series moving forward.
He's one of my favourite characters, so he's definitely in.
Definitely there. If you look around, they might be watching you right now.
What gives Alex his resilience?
I don't know what gives him his resilience. He just, I think what's amazing about him is that he's just this normal kid. He's an everyday kid who's not, I mean, in our show, he's not the most popular kid in school. He's just normal. And then he's thrown into these amazing situations and he has to just improvise and work it out. And I think what's amazing is watching someone so normal have to overcome those hardships and, you know, having grown up without any parents and his relationship with his uncle, which in our series is much more tense than it is, I think, in the books. So he's just got it within him that every time that he's under pressure or it looks like his back's against the wall, he somehow manages to just get away. And I think that's why it's interesting to watch, because you're not watching someone who finds it easy, you're watching someone who doesn't find it easy, but does it because he has to, because he's got, if that's the only thing that he's got to do it, you know.
There you go.
I hope that answers your question.
To everyone on the panel, what's your favourite Alex Ryder book?
Ooh.
I didn't read them, I've been really honest. but one of the biggest reasons I did it is because it's, you know, an audience, a completely different audience, and I haven't, but my nephew is a very good judge of character and he says they're all great.
If we're going in order, my eldest son liked Point Blank best. I've got a soft spot for Eagle Strike, partly because I'm thinking about it so much at the moment, because that would be our next series. Ooh.
I just know Point Blank, and I really like it.
Good answer.
I'm going to say Point Blank.
yeah, I think I already said, but Point Blank. I would say Eagle Strike's second, a very close second.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
I like all of them.
Which was the easiest to write? Are any of them easy to write?
I never use easy and difficult. I was talking about writing because I think that if it's difficult, something's gone wrong. Writing should flow. Writing should be energy and passion. And the moment you start feeling you're knotted and tied up and it's not coming, I stop. So, in answer to your question, Sydney, I love Russian Roulette. It's one of my very favourites because I'm so fascinated by Yasin and by the evil guy. But no, easy, difficult, I don't do.
Fine.
What are you most excited about maturing this character up for a slightly different audience?
What am I most excited? I think he's cool because you're going to watch from the beginning of the series to the end. You're watching a boy become a man, and you're watching him in that situation, but also have to become a spy as well. So he's also dealing with girls and friends and school and the normal things that teenagers deal with. So it's not an easy journey for anyone, but he muddles through, and I think it's going to be cool to watch. I don't know if that answers your question, but
I guess being a 14-year-old from when the books were first written compared to a 14-year-old now has changed quite a lot.
Don't forget, the first book was written 20 years ago.
Yeah.
And Alex in that time has aged only 15 months. I mean, you know, it's been a slow aging process. I've meanwhile aged 15 years. It hasn't 20 years, hasn't been fair. I think it's an interesting question. And what's great about Otto's performance is that he's obviously not 14 in that clip in the film, but the age is never mentioned. He is just sort of, it's a spirit rather than the year that's what counts.
Lovely.
I love the Alex Rider books, so I wanted to say that.
Thank you.
My question is about the show being more grounded in reality. Eventually, Alex Rider does get into some pretty surreal situations, like he ends up in space. Could we expect to eventually see that on TV?
Archangel, book number 6, sends Alex into space. I did a lot of research for it. Funnily enough, you would do much better in outer space than your dad would, because young people have more flexible bones and muscles and will survive better out there, apparently. Well, I think that if we get that far, and if Guy doesn't cut it, he'll go to space, yeah.
Is that what you want to see?
Yeah.
Good, awesome. Good.
Sony, are you listening?
It's got something for everybody, that's the whole thing. As to it, the big screen, I'm very happy being on this screen, on the TV screen. All the most exciting drama, in my view, is happening right now on the S-boxes, on TV. That's where all the action is. And, you know, this is exactly the film, the TV series, that I really wanted to see out of my books. So it's here and it's for everyone.